Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around a bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps a-rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. Bet there's rich folks eating from a fancy dining car. They're probably drinking coffee and smoking big cigars. Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep a moving, and that's what tortures me. If they freed me from this prison, if that railroad train was mine, I bet I'd move it on a little farther down the line. Far from Folsom Prison, that's where I want to stay. And I'd let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
Continue with my sister's address.
Okay.
And don't be writing her no more Alabama like you did before. Don't write my sister like you did before, man. Don't write my sister telling her that you're in love with her, dude. You know, man.
Well, she's as cute as you. Yeah.
She's mine. My sister's mine.
I just seen a movie, on TV last night. It was with
Flowers
Adam
in the Attic.
Called
Flowers
That's
in the
My
Attic.
Boy. Huh?
You watched Flowers in the Attic.
Did you? Flowers in the Attic.
You
That's
did.
A horror flick, right?
No, you know what it is, don't you?
No idea.
It's based on a book.
Like a horror film.
No.
Oh.
What did Alabama say?
He's got your address.
Yeah, give it to him. No, but I just use my sister's address because I don't have all the mail that I get here goes to her house. Like, just use her address. That's why all my stuff goes to her house.
Okay.
You know, hey, I was talking to Danny about. Actually, Danny was the one talking. He was talking about what happened there recently with the overdose, and how they shut down the whole prison.
Oh yeah. Yeah,
yeah. So that became a that
we shut down for like 2 days. Not full 2 days, but I don't understand why they shut down. They should just shut down the unit, investigate the unit, right?
Well,
that happened in Walworth.
That's what Danny said.
I believe right next to us.
This is what Danny said happened. What would happen is they would just shut down that unit, but now they're shutting down the whole prison. And the way he worded it is you're basically punishing the rest of the inmates in here. You're keeping people from having visits.
Visit,
now.
Doing visits, yeah, calling on the phones, yeah. When something like that happens, like, you remember the fight we had on this unit, our unit? and I say our because it used to be your unit, we had a fight with Spec. Spec got in a fight with, dude, they shut us down for like a week or so for that. Remember, they shut the whole institution for that, or maybe just the unit. Even if it's just the unit, yeah, they're punishing everybody for what somebody else is doing. It pisses a lot of people off, man. And it's just not right. Why am I responsible and being punished for something somebody else did?
You know, before you got to that prison, before you got to that prison was ran so smoothly.
All calls other than properly placed attorney calls made and monitored and recorded.
Yeah. Before I got here, it was what?
It was ran smoothly. You had, you would have three.
That's what I heard.
You would have three tracks a day per unit. You'd go on track with two other units you'd go to track with. And
wow.
And
now it's just one other unit. Track is usually once a day.
You know, what happened was when the COVID happened, that became a catalyst, unbeknownst at the time, but it became a catalyst
for
what's implemented now. Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, figure, you take you give.
I wondered. I always wondered what happened.
You know, give it. It's like a give and take. But I'll take, like, you know, people.
Well,
you know, they say.
Oh, now it's all take. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's take like, from the inmate.
But it sounds like the same out here. For instance, like when people give up, when people allow legislation to pass bills that limit the rights of others. And then it becomes like eventually over time, the more, I'm kind of losing my train of thought here, but the more, it's like what's happening, what happens in there is like what happens out here. You allow.
Yeah, the more you let bigger, it happen, the more you lose.
Yeah, Big Brother gets bigger.
It.
Big Brother gets bigger and people allow
more
it.
More control they have.
Yeah, and then you lose that control. You lose those freedoms.
Yeah. And I don't think it should be about control. It should be about a consistency, professionality, you know, a mission about safety, you know, safety and security of the inmates, of the COs, and, you know, get back to that main deal. I mean, these COs here are so far off professionality, man. It is unbelievable, man. I mean, we got some COs that come in here and think we're their children. They literally yell at us at the top of their lungs when they have so many other options. You could give warnings. You could give room. You could give warnings. You could give tickets, major, minor. You could give room confinement. There's so many other ways that they can deal with the situation, yet they want to yell at us. I mean, literally, I shit you not. At the top of their lungs, yell at us. That's so disrespectful. And then they wonder why some of these guys are the way they are, because they just lose total respect for the professionality of the state employees. You know, and what do you do then? When communication and respect and just has broken down because. You know, as an inmate, all you feel they do is belittle you, treat you subhuman, and condescend you. And, you know, and then they use staff discretion for everything they want to, you know, if it does, you know, the rules really don't matter. When a CO says this and it's not a rule, they just made it up on the spot. They say, well, we have staff discretion. What the hell? Why print out a rule book? If you have sole staff discretion, why have rules? Why have a policy? Why have DIA, you know, I mean, DAI, whatever. Why have anything like that? Let the COs just run amok and try to amass control. Watch how really wrong that could go. I mean, that, you know, things could really go wrong in that aspect of the situation. I don't want to be here when that happens, honestly. It happened at Rick Granite three times.
Share that story with the listeners.
The Rick Granite?
Yeah, you remember the one you told me about.
There were certain COs that would, like, literally condescend just treating inmates like shit. You know what I'm saying? You know the ways. Disrespect, condescend, belittle, treat you like you're subhuman. And then if you don't do what they say or any situation arises and they give you a ticket, they'll trump it up. They'll make it one-sided. They'll make you look like, you know, they give you the three D's, disrespect, disobeying orders, and disruptiveness. And you just can't fight that. You just can't fight that. COs will back COs. Every CO in here, every state employee will back another state employee, whether they lie or not. That was happening at Red Granite. They trump up tickets. They would lie through their teeth. So one day, the one sergeant, I forget her name, she actually left because she had cancer or something, but she was really just, I don't know if she was just hating on inmates or she's having problems bringing up to work. I don't know what the deal is, but she was a very, very miserable person, and she would come to work and take it out on inmates. One day, she went over to a phone, and a guy was talking on the phone, and she said, "I told you you're done," and she hung up the phone. That's what started the whole thing. So guys, a whole bunch of people saw it. And you know what? They got together. They're like, you know what? If they're going to come over and do that, what's next? So they got together and they were like, we ain't going to take this no more. So we didn't go to a child. We didn't do counts. We didn't do nothing. They shut down the institution. They had, I think they had about 8-10 COs come over, a couple sergeants. They had a few white shirts. They had the top dogs, the warden, deputy warden, and security director all come to the unit. The only thing they did was try to compromise. They knew they were outgunned. And that's how I say it could really go wrong. This is a clear example of them getting out of, you know, COs and state employees running amok, unchecked, and then that's what happens. Inmates come to their, you know, every human being has a point where they're pushed too far, and that's what happened. I saw it. So they just took control of the unit, and the only thing administration tried to do was just compromise. But it took, a ways into the night. This, I think it started at like 10 in the morning. And it took till probably 9. It was probably 8-9 hours worth. And, you know, guys were finally like, well, they were saying, all right, yeah, we understand. You want more respect. You want to be treated fairly, decently, this and that. But after it was done, and guys were like, all right, you know, that's all we really want. We just, you know, we're human beings. We want to be treated like human beings that made mistakes. Because you guys could be on the same path tomorrow. If that's the case, you're no different. You know, they want to act like they're different. But then after it was all done, they viewed the cameras. They started breaking up all the guys who started the thing.
All calls other than properly placed attorney calls may be monitored and recorded.
They sent the ringleaders, some of them to Max, and then they sent they split everybody up and put them in different, you know, mediums and stuff. And then after it was all done, immediately it went back to right how it was. That's when I started writing stuff up there. Oh yeah, I started writing staff conduct reports. I was writing up the white shirts for not doing anything. I was writing up sergeants. I was writing up communicating with the warden and the deputy warden. I spoke directly to the deputy warden. He says, "Hey, this is just how it is." I'm like, "Really, dude? It's just how it is? That's all you got for me, man?" Not like, oh, we'll try to work with you. No, They just want a mask, and they think they have total control, but they don't. It's a figment of their imagination, of their thought process. They do not have control. They never will have control, because inmates have a choice, and there's no choice in control. If they were in control, inmates wouldn't have a choice. You know what I'm saying? And so I started talking to the warden. The warden started putting his foot down a little bit. I got a few people moved. You know, the security director moved. They moved him. They moved some others. I got a bunch of reprimands, so no matter where they go, those reprimands, their record, will follow them no matter where they're a state employee now. And they really hated me for that. That's why they moved me out. They kicked me out of Red Granite because of this. They told me it was a security risk when I went to PRC. And I was like, oh, okay. I'm not here for a pre-placement or nothing like that. Security just wants me out of here. Yeah, I was making them look bad. I was writing the top dogs at Red Granite, the top dogs at Madison, right? I was giving copies to them, always informing Madison and the governor what was going on at Red Granite. They did not like that. They did not like when you take a legal route and you make them look bad. But if they don't want to look bad, maybe they should be a little more professional and follow their, I'm flashing quotes here, their mission. You know, the mission that's on the wall right behind me. Their mission. Yeah. So, these are the things that are going to happen. It's unbelievable, the lack of professionality.
Well, where you're at right now, and you can't go in the back anymore after 9 o'clock. The phones are shut down after 9. They're treating it like it's a county jail.
Right.
And that's a problem because
I don't know if we'll ever get back. You know, it used to be open until 11:30.
When that warden came in there, he got rid of all the plants, which, I mean, you had guys, I guess, they're probably sticking stuff in the soil.
Well, yeah.
You know,
so,
but then
he got a few bad apples that ruined it.
But he got rid of the plants that were outside in those little gardens that they grew.
He did.
He got rid of that. Yep. So that's just all. What did they do? Did they put concrete over all that?
I heard they're gonna fill that in. Yeah, with concrete, right?
So now you're gonna.
That's crazy.
He goes and now he implemented that whole again, no showers after 9 o'clock. Everything's done after 9 o'clock. That's a county jail. That's a county jail atmosphere.
Yep.
The difference
it used
between
to
that
be 1 o'clock, right? A while back, it used to be 1 o'clock. Then it was 11:30. Now it's 9.
Well, I can understand, you know, the 1 o'clock thing. That's way out there.
Sure.
But 11. Okay, so you leave it at it was at 11:45. But again, like you know, now there's you know. The thing about being in a county jail is you don't have that much control in a county jail. And the dude to implement those rules there, that can make a bad situation for themselves if you had somebody that just goes crazy because they're going to say they're going to because who's going to come right away? In a county jail, you have sheriffs, deputies come immediately, and then you could be worried about the time that you're facing punching people. That are employees, but
1 minute remaining.
1 minute. Well, these guys are human. They're human. So, and humans can only be pushed too far to the breaking point. I mean, yeah, they always say, hey, you got to have control of this and that. We have all these rules and structure, but I don't think so. I think it's to amass total control, which is something they won't have. If you smother these inmates for so long, eventually. They're
going to
take a breath, and then shit's
going to
go wrong.
Yeah, well, you know, right now, basically, they're just keeping people in their cells.
Yeah.
Giving them no reason to go out and do anything, to find anything, to preoccupy
them. And you know, the shortage of staff really is not the inmates. It's not the environment in here with the inmates. It's behind the veil of blue. Because they don't stay long enough to get to know, really, the environment with the inmates. They always quit real quick.